A small talk on what I call realistic LAWA cameras, at least two of them. Remember that on Tuesday we did an exercise on building a very simplistic LAWA camera. That's not too far from reality, actually, as you might think. These LAWA cameras are pretty simple instruments, generally speaking. Source, guide, source. I'm not going to tell you anything about how complicated the guide can be. But if you think of the guide as a thing, and then you have a sample, and basically a bunch of detectors surrounding as much as possible, or as much as you can afford around your sample. But my point of doing this is to show you how to how that you can position your detectors around the basically how you can build a detector bank using a group keyword. And with that in mind, I would like to go on and show you how one could possibly make a spatially resolved polycrystal of any sort using a single crystal. This is reasonably advanced McStas use. And involves groups, jumps, and strange things. So please bear with me, but I can show you how you can do this. It's not necessarily the most easy way to do it, but for sure you can do an arbitrary resolution, spatial resolution, follow crystal type. Anyway, so this is. So, the one I'm going to start to focus on is Topaz, which is a LAWA camera built at the CSNS. I believe they now have all their 47 angular cameras installed in an attempt to fully surround the sample. I've tried to sketch that in this way. I only put eight of the detectors around the sample, but you can see the point there. So you have a source, a guide, and some sample in the middle here, and then you have flat screens put at a distance, and if you were to fill in the gaps here, you could imagine that you could have a full instrument simulation, almost completely covering the full height around the sample. How would you do that in McStas code? It's actually not so difficult to do that. You use arms on the sample position, but with rotations. Many arms. One arm per detector, pointing at the detector center where you want it. So you basically resolve your space in angles. Please remember that arms are very useful. They don't really cost anything in terms of computations. It's hard to actually notice them that they're there. So if it makes your instrument description a little simpler, it's a good idea to use extra arms.
And one further remark here. We usually say that you shouldn't let McStas components overlap. Of course, the arm that does nothing, it's only a reference point in space, that can safely overlap with anything.
Yeah. An arm, as it does nothing, has no geometry whatsoever, so it can be anywhere, overlap anything, and so on, because it never does it. It doesn't transport the neutron in any way. And then, because you now have a lot of monitors here, detectors without matter, problem. They are exclusive, and that makes them the perfect candidate to actually use a group. And in this case, you do need to make a group of it, because since you have detectors on opposite sides, if you happen to be on the way to this one, at least the neutron is now on its way here, but this one has reach me, the neutron would have to travel backwards in time. That cannot be, so there's probably something wrong with it, so we should probably terminate this neutron at once. And therefore, that, if you follow the chain of logic here, that means that this monitor ends up being empty if it's not. It has to be in a group. And it's also a good idea here to use restore neutron, restore neutron parameter to the monitors, which nicely puts the neutron back. Because otherwise we can get into some other strange problems. So, I'd like to actually switch gears here a little bit.
Quite simple.
It doesn't have to do it a lot of times in order to cover it. And then again, in the end, you put detectors or monitors where you want them. You can make copies of them. You simply have to override the file name and just make them relative to the any which way which arm you want. As you can see, it's quite tempting to use a script to write this because you need to copy the first one in all of the times, and then you only have to update the component name and whichever arm it's relative to. And you could even use a copy keyword to avoid writing the name itself. So you can. The other example I was using was the Centu, which is a JPARC power camera. It uses a cylindrical geometry. Again, I've only put in a few of the monitors around it because it's easier to see, easier to draw. And in this case, it's you can do more or less the same thing. You just put arms here and then position your detectors afterwards, and but you make sure that some of these arms are displaced slightly, so that would immediately give you a cylindrical geometry. And let's actually take a look at that as well. The way that one's built, it's really not much different. This. There's a whole bunch of dye. I might mention that if you take a look at the source, this is also the SNS source but with a different input file. So this is exactly the same thing as made on wave did with the CSNS source. Simply a different tally file coming from moderator calculations that you could use with the SNS source. And this is what they do in Japan as well. And so on. There's a bunch of things going on here. And in the end, once we get to the sample position, probably see that it looks pretty much the same thing, or at least very, very similar. There are a bunch of detector arms.
Texture.
Max mentioned it just before, that this might be the case of something, because you definitely get texture when you process aluminium, for instance, you roll it and so on, and you tend to make your crystallized orient in some direction. And this will manifest itself in sort of kind of this way. The power rings are not complete, but you will have there's not quite spots either like this, but you have some sort of elongated spots. And so we invented a concept for trying to deal with this situation. Now, to remember, this comes from an earlier slideshow that you've already seen, that we had a single crystal of power, and how can you go back and forth between these things. So in a group, you would either scatter on this one or that one. Obviously, you could use a union for this particular situation, where you have a certain number. But some concept I came up with is that you have a polycrystal and you make it a voxelized description. So you have arbitrary many voxels of single crystals that can have some orientation and different crystal structures and so on. And you cheat a single crystal into believing that it is many. And the concept goes as follows. So whenever a neutron arrives at this outer shell, which is now represents the extent of my big crystal, the polyphone polycrystal, I figure out I'm hitting this one, this little box up here, because the neutron comes in here, it hits this one. And then I translate the neutron to the center. Scattering happens inside here. In this case, it's a multiple scattering event. The neutron exits here. It's now here on its way there. So I apply an inverse translation. So the neutron is really where it's supposed to be, up here. And then we enter a new subcrystal, and we can hop back. And that means that this new one now can be translated down here, scatter around, and then be translated back. So we can keep doing that until we exit the full subcrystal, the full crystal domain. The idea here is that when we get here, we look up in the table to see what are the parameters of this subcrystal, which can be very different from this one. It can be even be a completely different material. And then we just inject the parameters of this subcrystal into the actual crystal module. Now, I'll try to show you that in code. The code here is available. just looking up from the position of the neutron, where, which subcrystal is it going into. And then there is some, there is a risk of getting stuck on a boundary between crystals, which we try to avoid here. And then simply, the idea here is that we have a map of the subcrystal that we've read in. So simply a lookup table or parameters for all of the little subcrystals. That's can be a big map, doesn't really matter. And then here is where this then is being put into the injected into the single crystal parameters. So you can actually, this way you can change the crystal, the parameters of a component while you're actually doing a simulation. Which is a slightly strange thing to do, but here is where we actually apply a translation to the neutron to move it. So we move the neutron to where the actual protocrystal is, the actual single crystal component is, which is in the center. So we move it from wherever it was. Remember where it was. And then we enter into a single crystal, do scattering according to that. And then this is when at the end here there's an actual, remember the dangerous jump from yesterday. We go back to the crystal, to the outer crystal, if this happens to be true, which is a flag about when do we actually exit. You can see when it's being set. That means if we're, if none of these make sense, that is we're on the way, we're exiting the crystal, outer crystal shell, then we set this flag, and that means that we don't jump back. And as long as this is true, we keep scattering around inside the crystal. And then we get to the end of the end of the parameter space. Now I know this is it's not easy to view actual code on a screen like this, but remember the concept that you can. The take-home message here is that it's actually possible to dynamically change the parameters of a component while you're running the simulation. And that means, in a sense, that if you wanted to target texture, for instance, where you have orientations which are random, but not completely random, so as to make the power, you have some kind of preferred orientation, you could do that by making a lookup table of all your orientations, saying that in this position of my crystal, I have this orientation. In this position of my crystal, I have this other orientation. And build a crystal model like that. And if you follow the chain of logic that falls down, you can actually do a... You can have a spatially resolved polycrystal where you have... Where you map different grains to different... to different spatial positions. In the crystal. Does that make any sense to you? So if you're interested in this, take a look at the code and ask me. I can explain it in depth. It's one of my favorite subjects.
how it is now?
I think that's so the exercise was thought of taking a look at looking into these things.
Okay.
We more or less already did that. That was pretty fast. Faster than I thought. Next is then science.
Yeah, but maybe I suggest that maybe we actually need to reserve some time to do that. So we can get yeah, so we propose that something like the next half an hour, three quarters of an hour, you have a look at this really complicated instrument, if you so wish. An alternative would be to proceed with some of the stuff that interests you from the earlier days. So things that go in the direction of your own instruments, or you build the lab that Eric proposed after. So that's the idea.